This is a group of amateur astronomers, and you all go out to dark skies and you see glorious and amazing things like this routinely. But of course, most people live in cities, and they see, you know, the moon and three stars if they're lucky. But, you know, prior to the invention of science, you know, back in the old days, no TV, no radio, no electricity, this was entertainment for most people. You'd walk outside at night and there'd be these starry patches in the sky. And this was as good as it got. For most of you in here, it still is as good as it gets. And, you know, in a pre-science era, not just pre-science, pre-literate, you know, you go back 500-600 years ago, you know, less than 1% of people could even read. And when you're in a pre-literate society, you're in a whole other world, a whole other regime, where there are very few ideas. The ideas that are introduced to you are given to you when you're 3 years old, and that's it for your life. And people, you know, they always desperately want to know where they are and what's going on. But in a pre-science, pre-literate world, it's a really important and difficult task. And one of the things that people had were these stars over their heads that maintain the same patterns every single day. And this actually becomes the initial paradigm for people's cosmology, for their view of their place in the universe. Because these things travel in these apparently circular patterns over our head, maintaining the exact same pattern night after night, year after year. And this, of course, leads people at this point naturally to believe they're at the center of the universe. And we can look up and we can see planets. We can see Jupiter and Saturn and Mars and Venus. And we can see that they were different from the stars because they move between the stars. But we did not consider ourselves a planet. We were the center of the universe. We were a special place, and the planet was simply something that wandered between the stars. So one of the big problems is if you're at the center of the universe, everything should travel around you. But if you look at these planets, in this case, this is Mars, and probably many of you have even done this with your star charts, you can go out, even because Mars is so bright, you can do this in the city, and you can chart the position of Mars night by night. And most of the time, it just travels in a pattern around the Earth that appears more or less circular, but once every 2 years or so, as we catch up to Mars and then past Mars, you get this funny shape where Mars suddenly moves backwards in its orbit. So we'll try to do this one more time. Here we go. And for a period of a few weeks, Mars appears to go backwards. That's called retrograde motion all through the stars, and then it goes forward again. So if the Earth is the center of the universe, and everything goes around us in nice, perfect circles, this is very difficult to explain, and this was the huge problem that led to the invention of science. This is a trick called epicycles, and in these epicycles, what you imagine is that the planet itself is not on this perfect circle around the Earth. Let's see if I can hit the right button here. The perfect circle is right here, it's this spot here, but the planet itself travels in another circle around this perfect circle, and with these crazy epicycles, you can get this apparent backward motion. So people invented this idea of epicycles. This goes back now a couple of thousand years, and it makes everything perfect, all perfect circles, they're at the center of the universe. It may be weird that the planet's going around a circle, but weirdness keeps getting worse and worse. Because as people make more and more accurate maps of Mars, this one little epicycle doesn't work. It gets further and further off track. So people actually then invented epicycles on epicycles. So here we have the perfect circle with nothing in it that travels around the Earth. And Mars goes around this epicycle in a perfect circle. So now instead this becomes a second epicycle, and Mars then goes around a third wheel. So you've got three wheels. So by the time the system collapsed, there were about 56 epicycles for Mars. So that's not really very satisfying. It produced an okay map, but over long periods of time it got worse and worse. The earliest gunshot in the invention of modern science is Copernicus. This is in 1530, this is still pre-science. But Copernicus suggests another alternative. He suggests that the Earth itself is a planet, it's not the center of the universe, and that all of the planets travel around the Sun. And the huge advantage with this is, so if the Earth is green and Mars is red, you see as the Earth passes Mars, you naturally get these epicycles again. And this is great. Now you only have two circles rather than the Earth in the center and then 56 epicycles here. The problem here still is, it's a much simpler calculation to make, but it's still not super duper accurate. You still cannot really reproduce the map of the motion of Mars. The problem at this point is that Copernicus is still requiring perfect circles. The idea of the Earth as the center of the universe is really important in pre-science, but also everything in the heavens is perfect, and the perfect shape is a circle, and everything has to be circular. And both of these were giant bugaboos that you could not get past without making people really, really angry. So in fact, Copernicus, being a smart guy, was aware that his publication would be revolutionary. And in fact, in those days, revolutionary simply meant traveling in a circle. The modern meaning of like political revolution or other types of revolution all derived from this, because he finally publishes on his deathbed, so that he's beyond penalty of death, and he writes of the revolutions. He's simply talking about the planet circling the sun, but the idea that this becomes a revolutionary idea and leads to the whole idea of political revolution and wars and so on comes directly from this. So this is one of the few things where astronomy predates social science, maybe. So at the point he publishes, this is 1530, like I said, less than 1% of the people were literate. And besides, all scholarly publications were in Latin, which makes things even more difficult. Really, very few people read this thing. But over the next half century or so, it gains more and more adherence. A lot more people become aware of it. They become aware of the beauty and the simplicity of it, and that it does no worse, in fact, in calculating orbits. And the sort of the Carl Sagan of this day, the Italian monk Giordano Bruno, writes in 1584, there are countless suns and countless Earths all rotating around their suns in exactly the same way as our seven planets of our system. The countless worlds of the universe are no worse and no less inhabited than our own Earth. So, you know, you read that today and you think, well, so what? I mean, this is the premise of every Star Wars and Star Trek episode ever written, right? But in his day, things were a little different. And publishing things like this did not lead to a good outcome for Bruno. You can see the idea of exoplanets predates modern science. Modern science, in my mind, begins sometime around 1608, when Kepler finally comes out with the first of the three laws of planetary motion, and leads directly to Newton and the whole physics revolution and everything that's come since. But this is what motivated it. And so exo-solar planets have been in people's consciousness, you know, going back to pre-science. And, you know, it hearkens to us, you know, are there the people out there? Are we it? Are we the only show in town? If so, it's not a great show. I mean, there must be something else out there, all these billions of stars. And so people have been looking to try to find extrasolar planets literally from day one. So the telescope is invented sometime around 1608, 1609, just exactly when modern science is invented, almost by coincidence. And people immediately began saying, well, maybe I'll point my telescope at a nearby star and try to find the teeny little planet. The problem is that even giant planets like Jupiter are about a billion times fainter than their host star. They only shine by reflected light from their host star. So if you're looking for, you've got a brilliant star right here, and then you've got even a giant planet like Jupiter right next to it, and the star is a billion times brighter, you can't see it. It's like trying to see a firefly in an atomic bomb blast. It's just overwhelmed. This continues to be the dream, to directly observe these planets. And this is a dream that people might actually achieve in our own lifetime. But up until now, it remains a dream. And in fact, extrasolar planets were a dream until only about 22, 23 years ago. When I started in this business back in the late 1980s at the University of Maryland, there were no known extrasolar planets. And if you went to an astronomy meeting and people said, what are you working on? You couldn't say, I'm looking for extrasolar planets, because Well, the reactions, there are only a few reactions. People might giggle at you, you know, or they might move away from you like you smell really bad. Or like, you know, you're trying to give, pass on some New Age religion. So you didn't talk about that at all. You just said, I'm trying to improve precision Doppler velocity measurements. So direct imaging has been a fantasy for as long as there have been telescopes, and hopefully we're going to see huge advances over the next 20 or 30 years in this. Transits, I'll talk about in just a second. Microlensing, I won't really get into. Astrometry, I'll just briefly mention, and then Doppler spectroscopy, which finally led to the breakthrough in this field. So in a transit planet, if you're really lucky and you're looking at the star, the orbit of the planet will cross directly in front of the face of the star. So once every orbital period, the planet will actually block some of the light from the star. So that's a transit. And here's an example. As the planet blocks a bit of the star, the brightness of the star drops by just a teeny bit, and at the end of the transit it ends. So that's really nifty. And in fact, the first transit planet was only discovered in 1999. Now there's a couple thousand known. And in fact, those of you who've got like 12-inch telescopes and good CCD cameras, you probably can detect these things for a few of the brighter ones. I mean, this is, you know, the trick is knowing where to look. You know, the fact is these things could have been discovered much longer ago, but people didn't know where to look because you have to be really lucky. The orbit of the star has to be such that, the orbit of the planet has to be such that it crosses the face of the star, which is pretty unlikely. But look at a lot of stars and you find these things. So the other main technique that people have been using to try to find extrasolar planets for a long time is astrometry. So as the planet orbits the star, it's not as simple as that. The planet and the star both orbit a common center of mass. So as the planet does a big orbit, it tugs the star into a smaller orbit. So for instance, Jupiter orbits the sun once every 12 years. It kicks the sun into a small counter orbit. And in fact, the center of mass of the solar system doesn't move. The sun, Jupiter kicks the sun by just enough so that Jupiter is just outside of this central point and does this 12-year cycle. And to first order, you can describe the solar system as consisting of the sun and Jupiter and some garbage. Everything else in the solar system is less than a half of Jupiter mass. Jupiter is the dominant body in the solar system. So that was kind of what we were fixated on trying to detect. We want to detect the biggest, easiest things first. So, in the astrometry technique, as the planet orbits the star, it kicks the star into a small counter orbit. And what you can imagine doing is taking lots of photographs of nearby stars and looking for stars that appear to wobble back and forth relative to background stars. So this is a technique that people have been working on for more than 100 years. And Peter Van de Kamp is especially famous for spending something like 60 years of his career doing this at Swarthmore University. And in the 60s, even announcing a couple of planets around Barnard's star. To date, those have not been confirmed. There have been people who said they don't exist, and we don't see them. But Van de Kamp was still just this enormous figure in the field, because for 60 years, he was kind of the only person pushing the field forward and saying, this is something we should be studying, and this is something we should be doing. And sadly, he died the year extrasolar planets were discovered. I think he made it to 100. So the technique that has ended up discovering, well, almost all of the first 200 extrasolar planets, and virtually all of the relatively nearby extrasolar planets, is the precision Doppler technique. And in the precision Doppler technique, you're relying on the exact same thing as in the astrometric technique. What you're seeing is you're not seeing the planet. You're seeing the gravitational effect the planet has on the star. So as the unseen planet orbits the star, it kicks the star into a small counter orbit. For half of that orbit, the star is approaching a telescope on Earth, and for the other half of the orbit, the star is receding from the telescope on Earth. So this then brings up the Doppler effect. when things are approaching you and emitting light or sound or any other wave function, that wave will get compressed to being a shorter wavelength. So astronomers call that a blue shift. And for the other half of the orbit, the star is receding. Anything that recedes, it doesn't matter if it's a boat or a train or anything that emits a wave, the waves will get lengthened. They'll get redshifted or stretched in astronomy lingo. So this is what we started working on in 1987. The problem is that Jupiter kicks the sun by about 10 meters a second. So if you're going to reliably detect Jupiter, you measure an error needs to be down to 3 meters a second. At that time, nobody can measure Doppler velocities to better than plus or minus 300 meters a second. So we had to improve the precision by about a factor of 100 over what people had done over the previous 60 years to get there. And that was our big technical problem. So here's just a brief view of what we're looking at. So this is, I had my system manager pull up some random spiral galaxy that would look more or less like the Milky Way. So this is one of these "you are here" things. And you know, we here in the solar system, we're way out on the fringes of the Milky Way. We're not in the city. You know, we're not in the suburbs. We're in the exurbs of the rural area. We're nowhere near where the big action is. And so if this is where we are, the various techniques work on different distance scales. Precision velocities and direct imaging and astrometry are all looking at the very nearest stars, that little pink dot hidden in there, the nearest 50 parsecs, which is roughly 150 light years. That's all we're interested in. The transit planets, they typically search for planets that are about 1,000 parsecs or about 3,000 light years away. And the microlensing, they look for things really far out, like typically 10,000 parsecs. So just to put everything in context. So at the heart of every one of these precision velocity techniques is a high-resolution Michel spectrograph. So for us, the telescope is just a light bucket. And the bigger your light bucket, the better. And so here we go. So the telescope, it's off the screen. All it's doing is providing the light. It brings the light to a focus at the entrance of the spectrograph. The light goes through the entrance slit. It's a collimating mirror. So you've got this expanding beam turned into a parallel beam. And it then goes through cross-dispersing prisms and then a very fast CCD camera. And the CCDs we have at the back of our cameras, you know, technically they're the same as the CCDs that are on your fancy telescopes. Except our CCDs cost $100,000 and have to be kept in a vial of liquid nitrogen. But other than that, and whereas you get these wonderful images of galaxies and nebula and so on, this is what our images look like. This is what a typical sunlight spectrum looks like. In fact, this is the sun. And this is what a Michel spectrograph does. It divvies the light up into these strips, these bands. So like, for instance, there's this band here. And each one of these bands is typically about 100 angstroms. So the human eye sees from about 4,000 angstroms to 7,000 angstroms, so about 3,000 angstroms. And what these shells do is they cut the light up into these little bands. So this is up near 7,000. You can imagine cutting along each of these strips and gluing it to the one below it, and you get one continuous spectrum. Prior to these Schell spectrographs, astronomers could either take very high-resolution spectra, but only over an angstrom or two, or they could take full wavelength coverage, but at really low resolution. And what these Schells do is they allow you to do both, super high-resolution and full wavelength coverage. And this was an important breakthrough. These things only came about in the 1980s. And in fact, the guy who basically designed and built the first modern Michel is Steve Vogt, and he was amongst my first and most important collaborators. I can honestly say everything I do is on Steve's shoulders. And he's rightfully called a spectrometer wizard because he was one of the first guys to figure out this design. The one piece of the puzzle that we've added to this is an iodine absorption cell. So the problem is starlight comes in through the entrance slit of the spectrometer, but the light itself is wobbling back and forth because of atmospheric refraction, because of telescope guide errors, the same problems you have. all sorts of things come in and cause things to jitter at a very low level. And that jittering all by itself causes an uncertainty in the velocity at about 300 meters a second. So our idea was that we would put this little Pyrex cell, it's about 4 inches long by about 2 inches in diameter, about the size of a Campbell soup can, and it's just sealed Pyrex. And in the center, there's about 1/1000th of an atmosphere worth of iodine vapor. And you simply mount this directly in front of the entrance slit of your spectrometer. And the starlight goes through the iodine cell, and it picks up the spectrum of iodine. And the iodine then serves as our wavelength metric. Because as the star wobbles back and forth, it's going to carry the iodine lines back and forth. And so our measuring stick is literally carried on the starlight itself. So one of the tricky things is that we only figured out 5 or 6 years into this project is that we have to really, really understand our iodine cell. So we really want to know what the underlying spectrum of the iodine cell is. And so we take every iodine cell to NIST, the National Institutes of Standard and Technology, up in Gaithersburg, about, I don't know, an hour or 2 hours, depending on traffic. And they have an atomic spectroscopy lab. And this is Julian Nist, who is the head of the atomic spectroscopy lab there. And this funny thing here is one of our iodine cells. And she blasts the light into this thing. So you're seeing the back end of this thing, but this thing actually stretches more than the full length of this wall. And it's in a giant evacuated chamber, and it gives you a resolution of about 1 million and a signal of noise of about 1,000. So our final spectrum is about as good as anything God could get. So we call it the sacred spectrum, and everything is referenced back to that. So, this shows you at the technical level what we actually do. This compresses 8 years of my life into one slide. This is about a 2-angstrom chunk of starlight. Again, humans see over about 4,000 angstroms. So this is, 2 angstroms out of 4,000 at super high resolution. This stuff in red at the top is the spectrum of the iodine. This is what we get from that Fourier transform spectrometer, the one I showed you in the previous slide. So this thing looks like noise, right? It's like grass. But every gidget you see there is real. And that's what allows us to move forward. And then this is what a typical sun-like star looks like over 2 angstroms. You see a stellar line, smaller line, there's a stellar line. And then the white dots here are what we actually observe when we observe the starlight through the iodine cell. So you see star line, star line, star line, star line. So star lines that have all the Doppler velocity information. We're looking for these star lines to move back and forth. And we care if they move by 1/1000th of a pixel. If they move by about 20 silicon atoms on the CCD substrate, that matters to us. So the star lines are what we really care about, but we need a wavelength scale to put them on, and that's where the iodine comes in. So for instance, here, there's no stellar line, but when you look down, there's this line here. That's this iodine. So we use the iodine to set the wavelength scale, and then use that to measure the shift of the star lines. And between 1987 and 1995, we were able to beat our errors down from 300 meters a second to 3 meters a second. And we discovered 5 of the first 6 known extrasolar planets and made the cover of Time magazine. Back in those days, it was easy to find a few big planets on the front page everywhere. It's a much harder game these days. Over the last 20 years, we've beaten our errors down to about 1 meter a second, and we're trying to get lower. So, you can make these measurements within a few meters a second, that's great. What does the actual signal look like? This is what the solar system looks like. If we were alien astronomers, if we were on Alpha Centauri, and we had this technique and we were looking back at the solar system, this is what we would see over the 60 years spanning 1960 to 2020. The velocity of the sun would appear to rise by roughly 10 meters a second and then fall by 10 meters a second. Periodically. And in fact, you can read it from peak to peak. You can read right off the graph. It's about 12 years. That's Jupiter. Okay? That's the big boy in the solar system. And from this information, well, the first thing you immediately get is the period. You just read it off the graph. The second thing you learn is the amplitude, and you can put those two things together to get the mass. So you know this thing's roughly a Jupiter mass. The other thing you'll notice is you've got a high peak, then a low peak, then a high peak, then a low peak. That's Saturn. Saturn has a period of 29 years, and it causes the sun to move back and forth by about 3 meters a second. So with current technology, they're the two planets in our own solar system that we could detect. The problem, especially with Saturn, is with the 29-year period, you have a life expectancy problem. So that brings us to 1995. It was actually only in May of 1995 that we had achieved 3 meters a second. And at that time, our huge problem was computer speed. We would take an observation of a bright star at a 3 meter telescope in 5 minutes. But at that time, with the state of the art computers, it would take us 6 hours to reduce the observation. We were in a situation where we couldn't reduce our data because with our two computers, we had to use all of our computational power to work on the software technique. And if we had simply used our two computers to reduce our 8 years of data at that point, it would have taken 5 or 6 years just to reduce the data. So, thankfully, in October of 95, the very first planet was announced, 51 Peg. And this was announced by the wonderful Swiss group of Michel Mayor and Didier Collot, who were working on a similar technique. And they reported at a conference that they saw this planet with what you can read off, this is days. So you can see peak to peak, 4 days, periods 4 days. And given the amplitude, plus or minus 50 meters a second, this thing's about half a Jupiter mass, so it's like Jupiter. So at that time, this got almost no publicity. It was the first planet ever, but nobody could believe it. I mean, a Jupiter-like planet in a four-day orbit, everybody knows. That's just nuts. That's just crazy. So we, fortunately, had 4 nights at the Lick Observatory 3-meter telescope about a week after it was announced. And that is right here. This is our first night, there's our second night, those 3 points are our third night, and those final 2 points are our fourth night. And since now we had only a single star that we cared about, we could turn both of our computers on this one star, and we finished on a Sunday morning in late October, and we drove back from Lick Observatory. I don't know if any of you have been there, it's the world's first mountaintop observatory. It's about an hour east of San Jose in California, and it dates to 1887. We were using the old 3-meter telescope, which was the second biggest telescope in the world in 1960, and seemed like a really big telescope to me. Mm-hmm. So we set up on the Sunday morning before we left the mountain. We started producing this final night of data. And then we drove back to Berkeley. It's about a 2-hour drive. And typically at the end of an observing run like that, especially when you drive straight back home, you're just dead tired. So I went back to my apartment, I crashed. And about midnight I got to my office, and these had finished reducing, and we got exactly the 4-day curve that was predicted. And we were amazed, and we put that first 4 days on the, at that time, the brand new World Wide Web. And it went around the world. About 3 or 4 days later, our phone started ringing, and it kept ringing for 6 months. It was just an entirely insane period. But you know, over the years, this is the first month of our data. Over the years, it seems like a metronome. It just goes up and down. It's got this one planet. So now these things are common, right? Back in those days, people knew these things are nuts. They made no sense. But we now know something about 1% of all stars have planets like this. And they're kind of nifty because you can put the whole thing on a single piece of paper to scale. So 51 Peg is a sun-like star. Jupiter-sized planets are about 1/10 the diameter of their star. And in this case, the orbital radius is about 11 stellar radii. So the whole thing just fits on a single piece of paper. So at this time, you know, just prior to the discovery of planets, everybody knew that all extrasolar planets would be similar to the solar system. And by everybody, I don't just mean like, you know, the science fiction producers and writers and so on, but every smart astrophysicist, every model for planet formation always resulted in a system that looked like the solar system. And if they built a model that didn't look like that, they threw it away and didn't even tell anybody. So 51 Peg was a shock because it's not like anything in our own solar system. And one of the very early additional planets, 16 Sig B, was another one of these things. So 16 Sig B, there's 9,000 stars in the Bright Star Catalog. And this is the star most similar to the Sun. If you overlay its spectrum on top of the Sun's, you could not tell the difference. And like the Sun, this thing has a planet, so the velocities rise and they drop and rise and drop. And the period is just about 800 days. And this thing is about a little less than two Jupiter masses. So okay, two Jupiter masses, that's fine. The thing that's shocking here is the shape of this orbit. The previous one I showed you, 51 Peg, that was a very S-shaped or sinusoidal-shaped orbit. Sinusoids or S-shaped orbits are the signal that you have a circular planet, a planet in a circular orbit. But when they are non-sinusoidal, you get weird shapes like this. And this is telling you the orbit is wacky, it's very eccentric. And if you were to overplot this on the solar system, you see just how wacky it is. This planet's got two Jupiter masses. It's the inner part of its orbit would go inside the orbit of Venus, and then would spend most of its orbital period outside the orbit of Mars. So if we had such a planet in the solar system, we wouldn't be here. Right? I mean, this thing is a giant gravitational wrecking ball. And this would be a terrible place to find life. And when it was initially found, people thought, oh, this is a wacky oddball. You know, this is 16 Sig B. That tells you there's a 16 Sig A. There's a companion star, which is almost exactly the same size, so both just about a solar mass. 16 Sig A is about 1,000 times the Earth-Sun distance from 16 Sig B. And people said, okay, sure. The companion star has been gravitationally tugging on the planet for billions of years and stretched out its orbit. That's fine. Your lateral wackiness, you can explain it and it goes away. The problem is that most of the first 100 planets that were discovered were in eccentric orbits. Eccentric orbits are extremely common. And that was another huge shock. So this idea of circularity, which really hung up the people in the pre-science days, continues to hang people up. So like I said, back in those days, you find a couple of crappy giant planets and you end up making the cover of Time magazine. And you can see some things never change. There's Eliza Clinton in the news. All right, so this is a good point to pause and then move on. In the first decade of extrasolar planets, you know, roughly from 95 to 2005, we had beaten our errors down to about 3 meters a second. This led to the discovery of giant exoplanets like Jupiter and whole new classes of planets that people have never dreamed of, like these hot Jupiters, like 51 Peg, and planets in eccentric orbits. But we realized, you know, if we're going to make progress in this field, we have to beat down our measurement precision. This field, it's a lot like auto racing, right? If you're on a NASCAR team and you're working on the car, your job is to make the car go faster. In this business, your goal is to beat down your measurement error. The smaller your errors, the smaller the planets you can find. And in this business, small planets are the sexy ones. So we've been working really hard over the last 10 plus years to get down to 1 meter a second. And I'll show you some examples in a minute. And then in the next 20 years or so, we hope to see huge advances in this field. With giant telescopes, maybe space-based telescopes, advanced adaptive optics, and hopefully even finally realizing the dream. There are so many levels of problems in this field. One of the problems is, in trying to beat down the measurement errors, is not all the errors are your fault. Some of them are due to the damn stars. Ideally, the star would be like a billiard ball. Right? It would just be this one nice solid surface and all the light comes off of it and that's that. But stars are these giant gas balls. They're like a million miles across and they ring like bells. The Sun rings, it rings at millions of modes simultaneously. It rings like a bell. And this was, you probably heard of the 5-minute oscillation in the Sun. That was discovered in the 60s. And when I was in grad school in the 80s, they said, well, you know, the solar oscillation has got an amplitude of 25 centimeters a second, like that much. And I thought, okay, great, I don't care. That's so far below my error level, it doesn't matter. But it turns out it's not true, or at least it's not true to, beyond the first order. The average amplitude of the sun's oscillations are, in fact, about 25 centimeters a second. But on small time scales, like over an hour or two, the major, it's ringing. The sun is ringing like a bell, and with millions of modes, and the major modes can constructively beat for an hour or two at a time. And so we got time on UVES, the 8-meter telescope in Chile that's run by the European Southern Observatory. This is about 10 years ago. And we sat on Alpha Centauri A, which is like the third or fourth brightest star in the sky, and it's the nearest stellar system in the sky to us. We were using one of the biggest telescopes in the world to observe one of the brightest stars in the sky. And we would take an image every 30 seconds. And in fact, our images were typically 1 second long. It took 27 seconds for the CCD to read up. So we would observe for 1 second and then read up for 27 seconds and then observe for 1 second. But we had a couple of streaks like this, so this is over 80 minutes. And you don't need a periodogram or some fancy software to see the oscillation. It's going down and up and down and up and down and up with a 7-minute period. You just see it. And the amplitude is about 2 meters a second. So this is what happens when the major modes beat constructively. And this is hard. The star itself is creating noise. And so one of the tricks now is we have to sit on a star long enough that we can average over some of this noise. But there are many other sources of stellar noise, some of which we can work on and some of which are going to be limitations. So, after our initial success, you know, we got 3 meters a second, we discovered a couple hundred planets, we got a lot of publicity. That was the low-lying fruit. Finding giant planets like Jupiter is relatively easy, but it becomes boring after a while. And we tried to move into finding much smaller planets. What we find is that nature is basically cruel and vicious and doesn't give up secrets easily. And that the most interesting planets come in packed systems. And when you have multiple planets, you require lots and lots of data to disentangle the signal. So here's an example. This is 61 Ver. This is another one of these super duper sun-like stars. And we've been observing this at the Anglo Australian Telescope, where I was a staff astronomer back in the 90s, I lived in Sydney. And we typically would get, you know, enough time to observe the star 3 or 4 times a year. So you observe it over a year, you get a high point, a low point, a high point, and you're just stuck. There's nothing you can do. So finally, in 2007, they gave us 48 consecutive nights at the telescope. We've never gotten an allocation like that before. And so our goal was to pick about 20 stars, and we observed each star every night that we could. You can see there's gaps here because of the weather. The weather gods are one of the many, many malicious gods that try to crush the spirit of astronomers. But it was with this data set we could finally crack the problem, because now we could follow it every night, and you can see there's this 4-day pattern. Except now the amplitude is about 2 or 3 meters a second. This thing is about 5 Earth masses in a 4-day orbit. Plus this longer period planet that's about 1 month long. That's about a Neptune mass. And then when you have even more data, you find an even more distant planet. So there's the 5-day or the 4-day planet with 5 Earth masses. This is a Neptune mass. It's about 15 Earth masses in a 1 month orbit. And there is, in fact, a 2-Neptune mass planet in 3-month orbit. So this is one of the very first super-Earths ever discovered. Super-Earth is another type of planet that we never dreamed of. Things that are more massive than the Earth, but less massive than Uranus and Neptune. And we now know these things are incredibly common. In fact, they're the most common type of planet we currently know about. About 30% of all stars have super-Earths. And there are no such thing in our own solar system. But almost all of these super-Earths come in these packed systems. And the only way to disentangle that when you have multiple signals is to take lots and lots of data. And that requires a lot of telescope time. So that's a really hard game to play. Another early example of this is back around 2010. And this is a system in which there, as you can see, there's a ton of data. The blue data is from the HARPS telescope, the Swiss Precision Velocity Telescope in Chile. And the red data is from our Keck telescope survey. Keck is the world's biggest optical telescope on the hopefully extinct volcano of Mauna Kea. And each telescope here is providing about 120 observations. So it's 240 total observations. And that's what it took to pull out all of these signals. A 3.5-day planet, a 5.7-day planet, 12.9, 37, 67, 433. And this is an enormous commitment of telescope time. And it's very competitive. You're applying for telescope time. The telescope allocation committees look at everybody's proposals. And it's very painful and expensive to get all this time. But this was especially exciting. Because the host star, LISA 581, is a little red dwarf, a little M-dwarf star. So for the Sun, being a much bigger star, the habitable zone, this thing in blue, the habitable zone is roughly the area in which a planet might potentially have liquid water on the surface. That's all an astronomer means by habitable zone. Astronomer does not mean there's life. I am not a biologist, and I don't even play ball in television. But for Sun-like stars, the habitable zone is out here, like at Earth orbital distance. But for these little M-dwarfs, because they're only putting out about 1% as much energy as the Sun, the habitable zone is much closer. It's typically anywhere from about 8 or 10 days out to about 30 or 40 days. And that 37-day planet that I just showed you, it's right smack in the middle of the habitable zone. And this thing's about 2 Earth masses. So this is one of the first potentially habitable planets that was found. So one of the joys of being a professional astronomer is spending time at beautiful observatories a long way away. And so this is Las Campanas. It is the Carnegie Observatory's observatory in Chile in the southern Atacama Desert. We're at about 8,000 feet, and we have these two 6.5-meter telescopes. Carnegie owns 50% of them, and then Harvard owns 20%, and then MIT, Michigan, and Arizona each own 10%. And in addition, there's a cluster of smaller telescopes over here. And if you want some seriously dark skies, this is probably the best site in the world. It has the best natural seeing of any observatory in the world. The median seeing is 7/10 of an arc second, and you get stretches of several days at a time where the seeing drops to 4/10 of an arc second. And the main reason I went to Carnegie, honestly, is telescope time. Goal was to improve precision from 3 meters to 1 meter a second. And, you know, we've already invested more than 15 years of software. But honestly, we needed better hardware. And so this is at the Carnegie Observatory's laboratory in Pasadena. The new planet-finding spectrometer had just been finished. And it was sitting in the laboratory. This is before we shipped it to Chile. And I love showing this photograph. This is Steve Sheckman, who was about 2 years ago voted into the National Academy of Sciences. He did the initial design on the spectrometer, and this is Jeff Crane. He actually did all the subsequent fine design as well as built most of the spectrometer. And so the thing is sitting in the lab, and I desperately wanted some light through it so that I could begin writing the software for the data reduction. So Chuck picks up a mirror, and he's bouncing sunlight from the mirror into the spectrometer. The reason this is so cool is because when you become a guru at this level, you actually can become one with your instrument. So this is the planet-finding spectrometer. It's mounted at the Naismith focus on the 6.5-meter Magellan. So the primary mirror is actually just behind this blue wall here. And the light goes off the mirror up to the secondary, down to tertiary, and then it enters the spectrometer right about where that green dot is. And you can see it's surrounded by this thick styrofoam padding. with the one wall off so that you can see it. But in fact, in reality, there's always this additional wall of styrofoam right here, 4 inches of styrofoam everywhere. And we temperature maintain this thing to about 1/100th of a degree centigrade. So it's always 27 degrees centigrade, plus or minus about 1/100th of a degree, so that we get extra stability. And this is what you get for all of this trouble. This is an earlier spectrometer we had at Las Campanas, and this is a known planet with a standard 1400 day orbit, and we had initially discovered it with this earlier telescope, but you can see the scatter to the data is not great, it's about 7 meters a second, and here's the data we get with the new spectrometer. And the scatter is 1 meter a second. So with that kind of precision, you can now find much smaller planets. And this is a lead into an example. This is a planet we discovered at the Anglo-Australian Telescope, about 8 hours drive from Sydney. They're very proud of the fact they have very dark skies. But if you go anywhere in Australia, more than a few miles outside of the city, they have very dark skies. So this is an M dwarf, one of these little red dwarf planets, and this period is about 9 years. And this thing is about 60% of the Jupiter mass, so it's a Jupiter-like planet. And this was exciting because it was one of the very first Jupiter-like planets ever found with a Jupiter-like orbit, and one of the only known ones still around one of these faint M dwarf stars. But as you can see from the scatter, we're stuck at the AAT. We just can't do any better. It's a 3 meter, 4 meter telescope with an old spectrometer. And here is the same star. The green is the old AAT data. The red is the HARPS data, and the blue is the planet finding spectrometer data. And you can immediately see how much better the data is. And in fact, the data is now so good, you throw out the AAT data, and you can now look for residuals in this. And when you do that, another planet pops out. This thing's in a 33-day orbit. The amplitude's just a few meters a second, and this is about 5 Earth masses. So this is another potentially habitable planet. So I'm going to begin to wrap up here to just end on some of the latest and most exciting stuff that we've done. This is another one of my my great collaborators. This is Guillaume Inglada, who was a postdoc at Carnegie for several years, and he is now at Queen Mary's University in London, but he's becoming so famous that he's probably going to blow up to some even bigger and brighter place. And his idea was to look at Proxima Cent. So I already mentioned Alpha Cent. Alpha Cent A and B are the two nearest sun-like stars in the sky, but it's a triple system, and there's Proxima Cent. And the name is Proxima, it's the nearest star in the sky. It's just a little bit more than about 4 light years away. And it's one of these little red M dwarf stars. And Guillaume's idea was to observe this thing very heavily. You saw previously observing stars every single night for a couple of months on end. So that was Guillaume's idea. And he got time on HARPS, the telescope in Chile. And he also got data from a previous project, also in Chile, using the 8 meter VLT, very large telescope. And that group had published their data they took between 2000 and 2007. They published that in 2009. And that's the data in red. And the scatterer was a little bit too much to see anything. But it was taken with the technique that I invented, the iodine technique, and Guillaume asked the UVES team if they would give me their data. And so they gave me their data about a year and a half ago, about January of last year. And I spent about 6 weeks working on it, and I was able to reproduce the stuff in blue. And the scatter is reduced by about half. And with that, we were able, well, here's an example. This is a 16-night data stream, and their data is in red and mine is in blue, and you're already beginning to now see a signal in the blue of about 11 days. So if you combine this with the data that Guillaume got from HARPS, the HARPS data is these circles. It confirms the period, and it's in phase. When the UBES data is high, the HARPS data is high. When the UBES data is low, the HARPS data is low. And it required both telescopes to confirm the signal, because this is a two-Earth mass planet. It's in an 11-day orbit around the nearest star in the sky, and it's smack dab in the middle of its habitable zone. So the very nearest star in the sky has a potentially habitable planet. And this may be the cover of Nature last August. So Nature's kind of like being on the cover of the Rolling Stone in astronomy. So, you know, we're finding planets that you can't see. And what people really want is planets you can see. But just seeing a planet in and of itself isn't actually going to be that interesting. If, when the technology finally gets to this point, which could be just 20 years from now, the planet's going to be a single pixel. You're not going to see the espresso bars at the edges of the beaches with the aliens leading up to us. But what is exciting is you can take that light and you can now pass that light into a spectrograph. So if you can take, so this is an example, this is an annulling interferometer where you combine the light from several telescopes out of phase. So you block out, the light actually cancels from the various telescopes, and you block out the central star, and then you get these little bands where you might hope to see the planet. And so that's the sort of image we're talking about. But if you can do that, and you can pass this light from the planet into a spectrograph, you're then beginning to explore the chemistry of the atmosphere. And if you saw water vapor and oxygen or ozone, that would be a game changer. Right now, if you say a planet's habitable, people are going to say, oh yeah, right, you know, come on, show me. And the truth is, nobody can show. It's all just conjecture. But if you saw things like water vapor and any gas wildly out of thermodynamic equilibrium, like oxygen, that you would flip the question. It would no longer be proved that there is life there. The question would be, how can this be anything but life? So that's hopefully where we're going to end up in the next 20 years or so. And so I'll conclude this talk, as all talks of this nature must be concluded, with Frank Drake. Frank Drake started the search for extraterrestrial life back in 1960. He used telescopes in Green Bank, West Virginia, and his idea was, if they were broadcasting the equivalent of I Love Lucy around the nearest stars, we should actually see the radio signal. And he looked at the two nearest sun-like stars, and he didn't see anything. And that's begun, you know, the 50-plus year, almost 60-year quest now to find extraterrestrial intelligence. And a year or so later, Frank was organizing a conference, and he realized he needed an organizing principle. So he came up with what I guess is probably the second most famous equation of the last century, the Drake equation. And in the Drake equation, Frank is trying to estimate the number of communicating civilizations in our own galaxy. And this is an important thing to realize. If there are no communicating civilizations in our own galaxy, that doesn't mean that there isn't intelligent life. There might be in other galaxies. After all, there's something like a trillion galaxies. But if they're in another galaxy, the truth is, honestly, we have no hope of ever detecting them ever. They have to be in our own galaxy to have a prayer. So with that as the premise, there's just a number of, these are just parameters. It's not like equals MC squared, which tells you deep, profound physics. These are just parameters. And you can estimate the number of communicating civilizations by multiplying the rate of formation of suitable stars to the fraction of those stars that actually form planets, times the number of Earths per planetary system, times the fraction of the planets where life develops, times the fraction of life size where intelligent life develops, times the fraction of planets with technology, and then the lifetime of communicating civilizations. So what makes a planet, what makes a culture or a civilization intelligent in the Frank equation is basically that they can build radio telescopes. And until you have radio telescopes, you have no way of communicating between stars, and therefore you're not intelligent. You might have a whole planet of Shakespeare's, right? But you're not intelligent because you don't have radio telescopes. So as such, we only became intelligent sometime roughly about World War II. And then the whole issue of how long does that civilization last? So when Frank wrote this down in the early 1960s, the only thing that was known was the rate of formation of suitable stars. That was it. We know that there are something in the ballpark of about 400 billion or trillion stars in the Milky Way. That's the only thing that was known. We didn't know of any other planetary systems, so we didn't have any idea what the fraction of stars were planets. We certainly didn't know any of these other things. And anybody could put in any estimate they want. And some people put in various estimates for these things and come up with tens of thousands of communicating civilizations. Other people would put in numbers and come up with less than one. And they were all equally valid because there's no data. So where we've come in the last just 22 years is really pretty remarkable. We can now answer the second question, what fraction of stars have planets? It's pretty darn close to 100%. Planets are just dirt cheap. They're just a natural byproduct of star and planet formation. And the number of Earth-like planets per planetary system. The estimate there is a little bit shakier, but it's pretty robust, about 30%. About 30% of planets have potentially have, about 30% of stars have potentially have little planets. Really common. It's good that there, the other things aren't known, because young people need PhD theses. But where we're going, in the next 20 years, I think we're going to be attacking certainly this next question. When we can do direct detection of planets and we can start studying their atmospheres, we'll begin to, for the first time, put some limits on the fraction of systems that actually, where life actually develops. And as for the other ones, well, you know, some alien might send us a radio transmission or some other transmission tomorrow, or not. You know, that's where we've been for a long time now. But this is a nice place to end the talk because it brings full circle that extrasolar planets and the search for alien lives literally predates modern science, leads to the creation of modern science, and continues at the forefront of modern science. So thank you very much.